All right. Tesla Model 3 Performance with Performance Upgrade Package. Test number one, 0 to 60 with stock 20-inch wheels and tires. And off we go. And that was a run in 3.20 seconds, friends, on dead level ground here. We're gonna do a two-way run just to make sure that we don't have any issues. And run number two, go. Seconds, exactly again. Run number three, eastward bound again, 0 to 60. 88% SOC, and we are gone. Again.
How fast is that?
3.20, all four runs. Yeah, it says we're making 446 horsepower at 55 miles an hour. That's eerily accurate because the factory rating is 450.
Yeah.
And the amazing thing is it has a horsepower calculator.
Yeah.
The car is 450 rated. You know what this says? 446. That's pretty impressive. Yeah, yeah. That was a 3.17.
3.17?
Shut up! Let's put some wheels on this thing.
Yeah, let's go, man. So here we have the original OE package that comes anytime you buy a Performance Model 3 with the Performance Upgrade option. Note that it's the same style that you can also optionally buy in the US for any Model 3. This wheel is available as an accessory package for standard Model 3, but there's something specific to the design of this wheel that we're going to see a little later when we take it apart to fit the brakes that are on the Performance Upgrade package. And that's a really important detail I want everybody to know if you're planning on changing the wheels. Or even if you're just picking up a second set for winter. So let's get the wheels off and start poking around underneath. We'll see what I'm talking about. Here we go. So let's first look at what's going on the hub. From afar, this looks like a pretty standard setup. You've got a brake rotor, you've got a brake caliper, you've got five studs, and you've got a little hub pointing out here, which is what centers the wheel on the car. And normally you have a machined hole in the back of the wheel called the center bore, which corresponds just about exactly. You don't have about a 0.1 millimeter gap between the wheel and this, so that no matter what the temperature is or if it gets a little dirty or corroded, the two fit together. But you want a nice tight fit because that's what's gonna center the wheel. Now, common misconception is the weight of the car is supported on the hub. That is not true. Once the wheel is bolted on the car, in the case of a Tesla like this Model 3, there is 71,000 pounds of force holding the wheel to the car. When you calculate the 14 by 1.5 millimeter stud times five studs, torque to 129 foot-pounds, that's the resulting force on the hub. It's in the neighborhood of about 71,000 pounds. So trust me, once that's bolted down, it's not going anywhere. This hub does not need to be there, except when you install it on the car, that's what's holding it center. If not, even with a conical nut, there's a risk when you bolt it down, it'll be a little off center, and then it's gonna do the towels and the dryer thing or washing machine, and it's gonna be digga digga digga. You're gonna get an out of round condition, you're gonna get vibration. So you want this to fit tightly. In this case, what's interesting about the Performance Model 3 with the upgrade package is it would seem somebody who had the hub designed and somebody who decided to add these beautiful modular brake rotors, which are works of art, didn't quite communicate effectively, because you'll notice there's this additional little step at the end, which is larger in diameter. And that's because the OE cast rotors are thicker. They cover that up, as they do on all other cars. So this would just mate perfectly. The 64 millimeter bore would match a 64 millimeter hole in the wheel, and life would be good. In this case, we've got this little extra step. As Trevor likes to say, what do you do when you live in a shoe? Well, you gotta come up with some sort of a solution to this. And the solution to that, I think, for the sake of expediency, was to machine the back of the wheel. On the back of the wheel is, look at this. And this is unique to the cars with Performance Upgrade, is they have this additional ring machined in the back of the wheels to accommodate that step. Mm-hmm. So if you're swapping OE wheel to OE wheel, hey, life is good, nothing to worry about. However, if you want to put any other type of wheel on the car, including a standard 19-inch, let's say for winter, from a regular Model 3, you won't be able to do that. This is going to interfere with that. Mm-hmm. So your options are machine that same ring into the back of your wheel, which you can do. Don't ever do that unless you have the explicit written authorization of the manufacturer, because if the wheel blows up or cracks and you die, you are responsible. However, some companies can do the structural analysis on this. The technicians, the engineers will sign off on it and they'll say, yeah, you can do that and we'll pass testing. But wheels are a critical safety component of your car. You should never modify them unless they've been stress tested and signed off by an engineer to say that, yes, whatever you're doing to that wheel, it'll pass testing. We physically tested it. I mean, I cannot overemphasize that.
We're going to put these wheels on, but before we do that, we're going to use this little contraption right here, a ferro. And it's a 3D mapper. We're going to take this little puppy and we're going to 3D map braking parts for the Performance Model 3. As far as I know, this is the first time this is ever going to be done.
So what we have here is the OEM Model 3 Performance upgrade wheel. It's a 20 by 8.5 flow-formed wheel, meaning that the overall construction of the spoke and hub area is done by casting. And then the barrel section, the width of the wheel, is done by a rotary forging process. Kind of like if you can imagine how a vase is made, where you start with sort of flat piece of clay and you work with fingers and you stretch it into a cylindrical shape. The same thing is done here, except that it's done by a giant robot with mechanical rollers and pressed against a steel die, and it stretches the barrel of the wheel into its final shape. And while it's compressing it, it thins the metal out, aligns the grain structure, and increases the strength and reduces the amount of material. So you wind up with a wheel that's lighter and stronger. You can make it much lighter, you can make it much stronger, or you can actually make it a little bit of both, which is probably the case with these wheels. Tesla tends to engineer their wheels to take a pretty good beating. For today's experiment, what we really want to know is what's the overall assembly weight? So what is the total wheel and tire weight? And then we're going to change to something a little lighter to see if we can prove specifically the car's acceleration. Now, I think it's pretty intuitive to think that if we remove any weight from the car, of course, it's going to accelerate quicker. That's why people take out their back seats and trim and all sorts of stuff to make the car go quicker at the drags. But what we want to know is how much quicker can we make it by making the wheels lighter. And that gives you an extra advantage. Why does changing wheels or making wheels lighter that much bigger of a difference? Because you're not only making the whole car lighter, you're actually reducing the amount of inertia required, the amount of energy to get them spinning. And that is free horsepower. In effect, it's 2 to 3 times the effect. So if I take 1 pound of weight out of this wheel, it's the effect of taking 2, 3, sometimes 4 pounds, depending on the design of the wheel, but at a minimum 2 to 3 pounds out of any static part of the car. So we've got our precision shipping scale here, and I get 53.8 pounds. That is the reading for our OEM Performance upgrade wheel and tire. All right. I shouldn't struggle when I pick this one up. I should go, oh, light as a feather. It still does weigh a little bit. So this is our Fast Wheels FC04 competition wheel. It's from our race series. All of our FC series, the FC1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 now, all have that same type of construction as the OEM Tesla wheel. This wheel, I know because we make it, is exactly 19.3 pounds, which is pretty respectable for an 18 by 9 inch wide wheel. You're thinking, well, wait a minute, you're taking off a 20 and you're putting on an 18. Why? Number one, to reduce weight. The wheel by far is the heaviest part of the assembly. You can increase the diameter of the tire slightly to compensate. We have to put on a taller, higher profile tire. We're gonna go with a 40 series in this case. We're also gonna make it a little wider. So I hope to both increase the car's cornering performance with the width, give it a little bit extra ride comfort, a little extra protection for the Quebec roads, and ultimately try and make the car quicker by going to the smaller diameter wheel with the taller tire. I should mention we're using the Advance Sport V105. This is a new tire from Yokohama and they're ultra high performance summer range, very grippy, 240 tread wear. I think it's going to give us a fantastic result, not just for acceleration, but cornering performance. This will make this car a true track monster. 44.6 pounds.
Ooh, that's significant.
Isn't it though?
Wow.
So we've taken a huge chunk of rotating weight. So by reducing the rotating mass by the difference between the two, I think we're going to get a significant difference in our 0 to 60. There's only one way to find out. And we won't find out. This poses a problem, this little step on the hub, because what happens is if we try to get our wheel to sit on there, unless you have that little chamfered ring or relief in the back of the wheel, your most wheels are not going to work. So you've got two options here. Option number one is to put a thin spacer. It is a bit of an odd size. This hole here where the step is about 69.5 millimeters. So you need a spacer that's got at least 69.6 or a larger hole in the center. This one happens to be a dual bolt pattern forged aluminum spacer. It's the only type that we like to use around here. It's the same quality, if even a little stronger.
On the back edge, right?
Exactly. There's a chamfer on the back edge, so it meets up with the hub. But in this case, we've custom machined this. We put in our three-axis CNC, and we actually cut this to precisely 69.6 millimeters. So it is a perfect match for the hub on the car. Well, there's two things. First of all, any wheel that you put on this car has to be what's called cavity back. That means there has to be a hole in between the lug holes to accommodate this little bolt who's poking out. Now, if you look at the factory wheel, if you look at the backside, you'll see what I'm talking about. You see you have these cavities, so this is called a cavity back wheel. Sometimes when you go aftermarket, the wheel can be a solid back pad, and that's gonna cause a problem. You would have to have a relief hole drilled in it, again, by the company or authorized by the company in order to relieve the space required for that little hole. The problem we ran into when we tried fitting the spacers, of course, was if we line them up like so, boop, they're actually gonna hit the top of that little bolt. Our man Dan was kind enough to just very quick and dirty mill it out a little bit larger so that it'll fit over. So we've got a little relief on there. Yeah, exactly. And that'll line up beautifully with it. So that's how we're going to solve that. Option number two, if you're going with an aftermarket wheel that has a larger center bore, they will use what's called a centering ring. This is placed in the backside of the wheel, as we'll see in just a moment. And what this does is it takes the large hole in the wheel and adapts it down to whatever size you need for your particular car. Normally, same thing. We just put this on and it snugs all the way up. You can see though, on this car, if you look from the side, Trevor, looking in profile, you're gonna see there's a little gap back here. There's a little airspace. This means that the ring won't go all the way on. That means that the wheel won't go all the way on. So, how do we solve that problem? Well, we would take off this little chamfer, this little edge, which normally rests in the back side of the wheel. We've eliminated, I just quickly eliminated the chamfer off the back. We ground it off. This is now gonna fit on, like so. The wheel, as you can see, is free to go all the way down onto the pad on the wheel. Mm-hmm. So in this case, we're gonna use both solutions on this car. In front, I'm using a 18 by 9 with a plus 30 offset. I think the stance is gonna be perfect. I don't want to space it. So my wheel will go completely on. The cavity in the wheel will take care of this guy. And the fact I removed the chamfer means that the wheel goes all the way on. So in back now, we're gonna use the spacer solution. So basically, I'm gonna fit the spacer on the back here. So as you can see, it centers very nicely on, we did a little extra clearance on that, but it fits very, very nicely. It's gonna basically be centered on the studs as well, of course, and we've got that relief here to take care of this little bolt. Even though it protrudes slightly, the cavity in the back of my wheel also mm-hmm. takes care of it. Now this is a 5 millimeter spacer. Again, I'm using 18-9 square with a 255 tires all the way around. One of the funny things about Model 3 is it's actually got a lot more room in the back. This car, for sure, was designed for staggered wheels and tires. If you watched the reveal back in 2016, you might remember that the car, the Alpha car, the silver one, actually had wider rear tires on it. We saw photos, Motor Trend did the coverage on it, and you could see that it had a 275 millimeter wide rear tire with a 20 by 10 inch wide rear wheel. And you can actually fit an 11 on the back of this thing if you want to go full gonzo. We're not going to do that. For the purposes of our test, I want to keep everything light. And I also want the car to really be a monster on the track. So I want to stay square. Our friend Sasha from Mountain Pass Performance also agrees square is the way to go if you're going for track numbers. That's what I want to do. So we're going to go 255 all around, 18-9 all around, just to get that little extra stance, just to sort of fill in that rear wheel well, because we've got that little extra space. The 5mm spacer, I think, will give us what we need. And we still have enough stud length. Again, one of the interesting things, the car does not have enormously long studs, but because the rotor on the performance upgrade is thinner, we actually have an extra 5 millimeters of stud. You can see that. It's not threaded, but it's available to us. So you can put up to about an 8 millimeter spacer on the performance upgrade car and still have plenty of stud engagement. On a regular Model 3, that's not going to happen. You can only put a 3 millimeter spacer before you run out of stud. Going on for our first dry fit, and it's looking good. I'm loving that. It's nicely centered. It sits nice and tight up against the hub. It's centered by that custom-made ring we've got back there. Tons of room. We've got lots of clearance up there. You can see, even with the bigger upgrade 355 millimeter rotors and these big four pot calipers, there's gobs of room back there. So no clearance issues with an 18 inch. And the sharp eyed viewers might be looking at this and thinking, hey, maybe I can get a 17 on there. You know what? I bet you with the right wheel you can. The problem is you won't be able to do that in the rear. So if you wanted to run a 17 front and 18 rear, you could do that. I think it's a little goofy, but if that's what floats your boat, you could probably get away with it. So now that we've got our spacer fitted, you can see we don't have to modify the ring. Why is that? Because we've now got a surface here that stands proud. Like any other car in the world, you can now just put a normal centering ring on there. It's gonna sit nice and tight up against our forged spacer. Everything is gonna fit perfectly, so no special ring required. There we go. Perfect. What you will see is there's considerably less space. This is the problem you're going to encounter if you try to fit the factory 18 inch aero wheels on a performance upgrade car. That top protruding part of the caliper on the rear will actually touch the barrel, the inside of the barrel on the aero wheel. It does not fit. So you need something that's got a larger barrel. In this particular case, the FC04 works nicely to do that. There's other solutions as well from a few different companies. So just make sure whoever you go with that they guarantee it's going to clear over this. So we're calibrating our Vector FX2. We are ready to go. This is our second round of tests. Fast wheels, FC04 18x9 flow formed wheels with the Yokohama Advan Sport V105s in 255/40/18. We are now going to see how much time we can shave off the factory setup by dropping 9 pounds per corner in 3, 2, 1, go. People, that was a 3.12, solid result. We're now going to make another run westbound direction on this exact same piece of road, and we're gonna need some averages of the two to see what we get. So let's get ready to rumble. Test run number two, westbound in 3, 2, 1, go. Another 3.12. All right. This car performs a little bit better once we've got a little heat in the batteries. Ambient temperature is about 25 degrees, a little bit warmer than what we had for the earlier runs today. In 3, 2, 1, go. And that was a 3.12 again.
Okay, what's the record? Did we break it?
3.12 seconds, man.
Ha ha ha, congratulations. Nice. 3.12 seconds.
There you go.
We did it.